Hello everyone, welcome to this session on osteology of upper limb. In this session we'll be revising all the bones of the upper limb. Okay, so any bone when we study under these headings. So I'll try to cover all these headings for each of the bones of the upper limb. Okay, so let's begin with the bone which is clavicle. So clavicle is which type of bone? Clavicle is an example of a modified long bone. Why it is called as modified long bone? Because it has got certain peculiar characteristic features which are different from that of a typical long bone. Okay, you all can read about the various peculiarities of the clavicle to understand why it is a modified long bone. For side determination, always we have to cover the side of a bone by saying three dimensions. We should say one point covering superior or inferior, one point covering medial or lateral, one point covering anterior or posterior. So for clavicle, we can say, for medial and lateral, we can say the medial end of the clavicle is quadrangular, the lateral end of the clavicle is flattened. Okay. And for anterior posterior, we can say the medial two-thirds of the clavicle is convex on the anterior aspect. And for superior and inferior, we can say this on the inferior aspect of the clavicle, there is a elevation which is referred to as conoid tubercle. Okay. Conoid tubercle should be on the inferior aspect. So if we try to justify by saying these three points, we can specifically determine the side of the clavicle. Then coming to the parts of the clavicle, in general we can say that clavicle has the entire shaft of the clavicle is divided into medial two-thirds part and the lateral one-thirds part. The medial two-thirds of the clavicle is having four surfaces: superior surface, inferior surface, anterior surface and posterior surface, whereas the lateral one-thirds of the clavicle, it has got two surfaces and two borders. Two surfaces are superior surface and inferior surface, and two borders are anterior border and posterior border. And these are the ends of the clavicle. This is the medial end of clavicle, this is the lateral end of the clavicle. Then there are specific features along the inferior surface. This projection we had already learned, this is the conoid tubercle. And there is a groove here which is referred to as the subclavian groove. Okay, and there is an oval impression here for for a ligament, that is costoclavicular ligament on the medial aspect. And on the lateral aspect, this conoid tubercle and trapezoid ridge, these two structures, they give attachment to the coracoclavicular ligament. There are two parts of coracoclavicular ligament, the conoid and the trapezoid part. Okay. Then various attachments of the clavicle. First, let's see the attachments of the lateral one-third of the clavicle. The anterior border of the lateral one-third gives attachment to a muscle that is deltoid. And the posterior border of the lateral one-third of the clavicle gives attachment to a muscle that is trapezius. Okay. So these two muscles are along the lateral one-thirds. Then along the medial two-thirds of the clavicle, on the anterior surface, the muscle is pectoralis major. Okay, on the anterior surface the muscle is pectoralis major, and on the superior surface the muscle is sternocleidomastoid. Okay, so these are the various attachments seen here. There is a muscle here, this muscle in the subclavian groove, the muscle is subclavius. Okay, so these are all the muscles which you need to remember for the attachments of the clavicle. Then various joints formed by the clavicle. The medial end of the clavicle, it articulates with the sternum. It is a saddle variety of synovial joint, sternoclavicular joint. And the lateral end of the clavicle, it articulates with the scapula, the acromion process of the scapula. That is a plain variety of synovial joint. Okay. Then coming to the applied anatomy related to the clavicle, the costoclavicular ligament which is attached here. So this is the region of weight transmission from the scapula to the clavicle. Okay, so since there is the region of weight transmission, fracture of the clavicle is most commonly occurred at the junction of the medial two-thirds and the lateral one-thirds of the clavicle. Okay, so here this fracture of the clavicle is common, and there is a congenital condition which is called as cleidocranial dysostosis. In this, the clavicle may be partially developed, partially absent, or it may be completely absent, and it will be associated with cranial bone deformities. Okay, so these are all applied aspects related to the clavicle. Let's move on to the next bone. Now let's learn about the scapula. Scapula is which type of bone? Scapula is an example of a flat bone. It is flattened throughout. That's why it is included in the flat bone. Okay. Then side determination. Again, we have to cover in three dimensions. So for scapula, we can say this coracoid process is on the superior aspect and it is facing anteriorly. So by this, we can cover two dimensions. One is superior and other is anterior. Okay. And for medial lateral, we can say this glenoid cavity is facing on the lateral aspect. Okay. So this is the scapula of the right side viewed from the anterior aspect. Okay. And here there is a scapula of the right side viewed from the posterior aspect. There is a specific feature on the posterior aspect as well. This is the spine of the scapula. This point we can also include in the side determination of the scapula. Okay. Then various parts of the scapula. Since it is flattened and it is triangular, it has got three borders and three angles. Okay. This is the superior border. This is the lateral border. This is the medial border. Then angles. This is the superior angle. This is the inferior angle. And this is the lateral angle, also referred to as the glenoid angle. Okay. Then other parts of the scapula include the processes. Here we can see this is the coracoid process. This is the spinous process. Okay. Spine is also referred to as the spinous process, which extends as the acromion process of the scapula. Okay. So these are the various processes of the scapula. This lateral border of the scapula is thick as compared to the medial border. Okay. It is very thick as compared to that of the medial border, which we can appreciate during side determination as well. This border should be on the lateral aspect. Then various attachments of the scapula. In the actual session of scapula, I had covered how to remember all the muscle attachments by formula of two. In groups of two, we can remember all the muscles of all the muscle attachments of scapula. So we'll try to recollect those. In the subscapular fossa, anteriorly, the muscle was subscapularis. Then along the medial border of the scapula, anterior aspect, here the muscle is serratus anterior. Okay, serratus anterior. So two muscles on the costal aspect of the scapula are subscapularis and serratus anterior. Then two muscles along the tip of the coracoid process, that is coracobrachialis and short head of the biceps. Okay. Then two muscles along the acromion process. One muscle is deltoid and other muscle is trapezius. When we see on the posterior aspect, the supraspinous fossa is occupied by a muscle. That muscle is supraspinatus. Infraspinous fossa, the muscle is infraspinatus. The spine of the scapula again has attachments of deltoid and trapezius. Then along the lateral border of the scapula, in the upper part the muscle is teres minor, and in the lower part the muscle is teres major. Okay. Then opposite the spine of the scapula, here there is a muscle rhomboids minor, and below there is a muscle that is rhomboids major. Okay. Along the medial border, we can remember these two, rhomboids minor and rhomboids major. There's one more muscle which is also along the medial border, but there's some slip of attachment here as well towards the superior angle. This muscle is levator scapulae. Okay. Levator scapulae and omohyoid muscle we can remember along the superior border of the scapula. Okay. But remember, the maximum attachment is on the medial border. Then along the glenoid cavity, there are two muscles. Supraglenoid tubercle gives attachment to the long head of the biceps. Infraglenoid tubercle gives attachment to the long head of the triceps. Okay. So if we cover all these muscles, there are two other muscles which are left. One is pectoralis minor along the medial aspect of coracoid process, and the other muscle is the latissimus dorsi, which is along the inferior angle of the scapula. Okay. So by this, we can remember all the muscle attachments of the scapula. Then ligaments attached to the scapula by the coracoid process. By the coracoid process, we can remember three ligaments: coracoacromial ligament, then coracohumeral ligament, then coracoclavicular ligament. Okay. So these three ligaments, with the help of coracoid process, we can remember. And there's a ligament here that is supra scapular ligament. Then talking about various joints formed by the scapula, the glenoid cavity articulates with the head of the humerus to form the ball and socket variety of synovial joint. That joint is the shoulder joint. Okay. Then the acromion process, it articulates with the clavicle. That is a plain variety of synovial joint called as acromioclavicular joint. Then in applied anatomy related to the scapula, there is one applied anatomy with in relation to the medial border of the scapula, that is winging of the scapula. The serratus anterior muscle, which is attached onto the medial border of the scapula, if the nerve supplying serratus anterior is paralyzed, the rhomboids minor and major, they pull the scapula behind and the medial border of the scapula becomes prominent. That condition is referred to as winging of the scapula. Okay. Apart from that, the medial border of the scapula is also a boundary of a region which is called as triangle of auscultation. Okay. In this region, when we keep the stethoscope, we can easily hear the breathing sounds. Okay. The lung sounds are clearly heard when the stethoscope is kept in the region of triangle of auscultation. Scapula forms one of the boundary of triangle of auscultation. Okay. So these are all features with respect to the scapula. Let's move on to the next bone. So here we can see this is the humerus. Humerus is which type of bone? It is an example of a typical long bone. Okay, so all typical long bones have characteristic two ends and a shaft. So here this is the upper end of the humerus, the lower end of the humerus, and this is the shaft of the humerus. Okay, and for site determination of humerus, we can say the head of the humerus is on the superior aspect and the head of the humerus is facing medially. Okay, so two dimensions we can cover by saying this statement. And for anterior and posterior, we can say olecranon fossa of the humerus is on the posterior aspect. Okay, that's how we can determine the side of the humerus. So here we can see this is the humerus of the right side. This is viewed from the anterior aspect, this is viewed from the posterior aspect. Okay, then various parts, upper end shaft and the lower end. Then in the upper end, the specific parts are the head of the humerus, this is the lesser tubercle of the humerus, this is the greater tubercle of the humerus. In between the two tubercles, there's a groove which is referred to as intertubercular sulcus, also referred to as bicipital groove. Okay, because the tendon of the long head of the biceps passes through this groove, that's why it is also referred to as bicipital groove. It has components. This is the lateral lip of the bicipital groove. This is the medial lip of the bicipital groove. And in between them, the region is referred to as the floor of the bicipital groove. Okay. Then there are necks of the humerus which are described. There is a neck here, a line which separates the upper end of the humerus from the shaft of the humerus. This line is referred to as the surgical neck of the humerus. There is a line here which separates the head of the humerus from the rest of the upper end. This line is referred to as the anatomical neck of the humerus. There is one more neck which is referred to as morphological neck, which is a radiological feature. It is the region where there is epiphyseal plate of cartilage. Okay, that neck is somewhere in between this anatomical neck and surgical neck, and it is a radiological feature, cannot be appreciated in gross anatomy. Okay, so these are all the features in the upper end of the humerus. Then the shaft of the humerus, the upper half of the shaft is circular and the lower half of the humerus is triangular. Okay, so in the lower half there is characteristic three surfaces and three borders. This is anteromedial surface here, anterolateral surface here, and behind this surface is the posterior surface. Okay, and three borders are, there will be anterior border here, then medial border, lateral border. Okay, these are the three borders. The three borders and three surfaces are seen in the shaft of the humerus. Then along the anterolateral surface, there is a rough elevation here that is referred to as the deltoid tuberosity. Then along the posterior aspect of the humerus, shaft of the humerus, there is a groove here which is referred to as the radial groove, which lodges the radial nerve. Okay? So these are some specific features in the shaft of the humerus. Then the lower end of the humerus, this is the medial epicondyle of the humerus, this is the lateral epicondyle of the humerus, In general, the lower end can be divided into articular parts and the non-articular parts. The medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, and certain fossa. Here there is just above the trochlea, this is coronoid fossa. Here there is radial fossa, and on the posterior aspect there is olecranon fossa. And there are ridges. On the medial aspect there is medial supracondylar ridge. On the lateral aspect there is lateral supracondylar ridge. These are included in non-articular parts of the lower end, whereas this is the capitulum and this is the trochlea. Okay, these two structures are included in the articular parts in the lower end. Okay, so these are the various parts. Then let's discuss about the attachments of the humerus. In the upper end, the lesser tubercle gives attachment to a muscle, that is subscapularis, whereas the greater tubercle gives attachment to three muscles. It can be remembered by a mnemonic SIT. Okay, where S stands for supraspinatus, I stands for infraspinatus, and T stands for teres minor. Okay, these three muscles are attached onto the greater tubercle. Okay, these three muscles along with subscapularis, they are included in rotator cuff of the shoulder. Rotator cuff, also referred to as the musculotendinous cuff of the shoulder. Then along the intertubercular sulcus, the lateral lip gives attachment to the pectoralis major, the medial lip gives attachment to the teres major muscle, and the floor gives attachment to a muscle, that is latissimus dorsi. Okay, so these are the various attachments in the upper end. Then attachments in the shaft, the deltoid tuberosity will give attachment to the deltoid muscle. Along the medial border, there is a muscle that is coracobrachialis. Medial border, middle 5 cm, the muscle is coracobrachialis. Then the lower half of the humerus, entirely it is occupied by a muscle that is brachialis. Okay, brachialis occupies the lower half of the anterior aspect of the humerus. Then when we see the posterior aspect of the humerus, just lateral to the radial groove, there is a muscle that is lateral head of the triceps, and this region is occupied by the medial head of the triceps. Okay, so two heads of the triceps originating from the posterior surface of the shaft of the humerus. Then attachments in the lower end, the medial epicondyle is referred to as the common flexor origin. The superficial flexor muscles of the forearm, they originate from here. The lateral epicondyle is referred to as the common extensor origin. Okay, the superficial extensor muscles of the forearm, they originate from the lateral epicondyle. Then in humerus, we should also be knowing about the various nerves related to the humerus. The surgical neck is related to the axillary nerve. The radial nerve is related in the radial groove, and just behind the medial epicondyle, the nerve related is ulnar nerve. Okay, these are three nerves related with the humerus. Joints formed by the humerus. Here there will be shoulder joint. Head of the humerus will form the shoulder joint, and the lower end there will be elbow joint. Okay, and in applied anatomy, we should know that whenever there is fracture of the surgical neck, this axillary nerve will get paralyzed and the muscles supplied by it will be hampered, that is the deltoid and teres minor. And the radial groove, when there is a fracture in this region, the radial nerve will get injured, and the clinical condition occurring because of that is referred to as wrist drop. Okay, then in the lower end, there may be a fracture here, that is referred to as the supracondylar fracture of the humerus. When this fracture occurs, the brachial artery and the median nerve are prone to injury, and the clinical condition occurs, which is referred to as Folkman's ischemic contracture. Okay, so these are various applied anatomy related to the humerus. Now let's move on to the next bone. Radius is the lateral bone of the forearm, and ulna is the medial bone of the forearm. Okay, so let's start with the radius first, and then we'll move on to the ulna. Both radius and ulna are an example of a typical long bone. Okay, then for side determination of radius, we can say the head of the radius is on the superior aspect, then the styloid process of the radius is on the lateral aspect, and this for anterior posterior, we can say this point, the dorsal tubercle of Lister, that is on the posterior aspect. Okay, if we cover these three points, we can specifically determine the side of the radius. So here, these are the radius and ulna of the right side viewed from the anterior aspect, and this image we are viewing it from the posterior aspect. Okay, then various parts of the radius, the upper end shaft and the lower end. In the upper end, the specific parts are, there is a head of the radius, just below the head there is the neck of the radius, that is the constricted part. Then this broad elevation here, this is the radial tuberosity. Okay, these are the three parts in the upper end of the radius. Then shaft of the radius has got three borders and three surfaces. The sharpest of all the border is the interosseous border, which is on the medial aspect. Then in the lower end of the humerus, the lower end, it actually shows five surfaces: anterior surface, posterior surface, lateral, medial and inferior surface. The anterior surface is entirely smooth. This is the region where we palpate for the radial artery. Okay, and on the posterior aspect, there is a specific elevation, that is the dorsal tubercle of Lister. And along the inferior surface, there is articular facets for scaphoid and lunate. Okay, the lateral articular surface is for scaphoid, the medial one is for lunate. And in extreme adduction, some part of triquetral also comes here. Okay, various attachments of the radius. Attachments of radius and ulna, I had covered in the previous session. Easily, how we can remember by formula of three. For radius, on the anterior aspect, there are three muscles. This part of the radius is referred to as the anterior oblique line. The anterior border, when we trace it upwards, is called as anterior oblique line. It gives attachment to the muscle, that is flexor digitorum superficialis. It gives attachment to the muscle, that is flexor digitorum superficialis. Then there is a muscle on the anterior aspect here. The muscle is flexor pollicis longus, muscle to the thumb. Okay, and in the lower part there is a muscle here, that is pronator quadratus. So these are the three muscles on the anterior aspect of the radius: flexor digitorum superficialis, flexor pollicis longus and pronator quadratus. Okay, then along the lateral aspect of the radius, there is a muscle here which is referred to as supinator. Then along the lateral surface here, the muscle is pronator teres. Then in the styloid process, there is a muscle that is brachioradialis. Okay, these are the three muscles in the lateral aspect of radius. Then on the posterior aspect, I've included one muscle of this region. The rough posterior aspect of radial tuberosity gives attachment to a muscle, that is biceps brachii. Other two muscles in the posterior aspect are, one muscle in the upper aspect is abductor pollicis longus, and just below it there is a muscle extensor pollicis brevis. Okay, these two muscles are attached onto the posterior aspect of the radius. So these are the various attachments. Then joints formed by the radius, the upper end, it articulates with the humerus. Which part of the humerus? Capitulum of the humerus. Okay, to form the humeroradial joint, a component of elbow joint. And there is a joint here, that is superior radioulnar joint. Then the interosseous membrane is considered as the middle radioulnar joint. And here there is inferior radioulnar joint. And below there is wrist joint. Okay. Among radius and ulna, only the radius takes part in the formation of wrist joint. Ulna is separated by an articular disc. Okay. So ulna doesn't take part in wrist joint. Applied anatomy related to the radius. One most important applied anatomy is fracture of the distal end of the radius, that is referred to as Colles fracture. Okay, in Colles fracture, this distal fragment is displaced on the posterior aspect, whereas in Smith fracture, it is a similar fracture, but the distal fragment is displaced on the anterior aspect. Then there is fracture of the styloid process of the radius, which is referred to as Chaffeos fracture. Then there is a fracture dislocation, which is called as Gallese fracture. In this, there is fracture of the distal third of the radius with dislocation of the distal radioulnar joint. Okay, this is Gallese fracture. Then the head of the radius, it may get dislocated. Actually, the clinical condition is called as pulled elbow. Pulled elbow, in which the head of the radius gets displaced from the capitulum of the humerus. Okay. So these are the various applied anatomy related to the radius. Now let's cover the ulna with the similar points. Ulna is also a typical long bone having three characteristic parts, upper end, shaft and the lower end. Side determination, for ulna, what points we can say for side determination? Here in the upper end of the ulna, we can say this is the olecranon process of the ulna, which is on the superior aspect. This notch here, which we can see, this is the trochlear notch, which will be facing on the anterior aspect. And for medial lateral, we can look for the notch which is on the lateral aspect. The radial notch of the ulna should be on the lateral aspect, or else we can say the sharpest border of the ulna is on the lateral aspect. For medial lateral, this also we can say. So by this we can say this is the ulna of the right side. Various parts in the upper end of the ulna, there are two processes. This is the coronoid process and this is the olecranon process, and there are two notch. This notch is the trochlear notch, and there is one notch on the lateral aspect, that is the radial notch of the ulna. Okay, and in the shaft there are three borders and three surfaces, as like in radius, but here the sharpest of the interosseous border is on the lateral aspect. For radius it is on the medial aspect, for ulna it is on the lateral aspect, and that's how the interosseous membrane is attached here. Then in the lower end of the ulna, there is head of the ulna and styloid process. Okay, these are the two features in the lower end of the ulna. Then attachments of the ulna, easily we can remember all the attachments by the formula of three. On the anterior aspect of the ulna, here the muscle is brachialis. On the anterior aspect of the coronoid process, the muscle is brachialis. Then here there will be flexor digitorum profundus, and in the lower aspect, pronator quadratus. Okay, these three muscles are on the anterior aspect. Then along the posterior aspect, now divided into two parts, posterior aspect upper end and the posterior aspect shaft. In the posterior aspect upper end, there are three muscles. One muscle here, that is triceps brachii, then there is anconeus and supinator. Okay, these three muscles are along the upper end. Then along the posterior aspect of the shaft, three muscles are abductor pollicis longus is one. Abductor pollicis longus is in the radius as well, it's in the ulna as well. Abductor pollicis longus, then extensor pollicis longus and extensor indicis. Okay, these are the three muscles in the posterior aspect of the shaft of the ulna. Then joints formed by the ulna, the upper end forms the elbow joint, then superior radioulnar joint, then the middle radioulnar joint and inferior radioulnar joint. Ulna doesn't take part in the formation of wrist joint. Okay, superior and inferior radioulnar joints are pivot variety of synovial joint, whereas this joint here, elbow joint, is a hinge variety of synovial joint, and middle radioulnar joint, it is a fibrous type of joint considered as syndesmosis. Then coming to the applied anatomy related to the ulna, so ulna can also get fractured. There is a fracture dislocation which is described in the upper part. Fracture of the proximal third of the ulna with dislocation of the proximal radioulnar joint, that is referred to as Monteggia fracture. In the actual session of ulna, I had told M for M. Monteggia is for M. M is the medial bone. Okay, that's how we can remember Monteggia fracture is of the ulna. Then in the upper end, there is something called as three-point relationship of the elbow. The three points are medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, and the olecranon process. Whenever there is elbow dislocation, this three-point relationship get disturbed. But when there is supracondylar fracture of the humerus, this three-point relationship is maintained. Okay, and there is one fracture which is referred to as nightstick fracture with respect to the ulna. Reflexly, one person flexes the elbow, ulna is the bone which is prone to fracture. Okay, so this was all about the radius and the ulna. Let's move on to the next heading, that is the articulated hand. So an articulated hand, we should be knowing about the carpals, metacarpals and phalanges. Okay, carpals are 8 in number. There are two rows of carpal bones, proximal row and distal row. Proximal row from lateral to medial are scaphoid, lunate, triquetral and pisiform. And distal row from lateral to medial are trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. Okay. In the actual session of articulated hand, I had covered the various peculiarities or specific features of each of the carpal bones. You can go through it. Then in the metacarpals are numbered from lateral to medial side. This is the first metacarpal, this is the fifth metacarpal. The first metacarpal being different as compared to that of the rest of the metacarpals. So at times it is asked, what are the peculiarities of the first metacarpal? So here we can see this is the shortest of all the metacarpals. It is rotated medially. Then epiphysis for the first metacarpal is towards the base, whereas epiphysis for the rest of the metacarpals are towards the head. Okay. These metacarpals and phalanges are included in miniature long bones. Okay. Whereas the carpal bones are included in short bones. Then phalanges are 14 in number, the thumb having 2 phalanx and the rest of the fingers are having 3 phalanges, proximal phalanx, middle phalanx and distal phalanx. Okay. And applied anatomy related to the articulated hand, we had covered the scaphoid bone fracture. Scaphoid is the most common bone to be fractured in the carpal bones. And when the scaphoid bone fracture occurs, it leads to a clinical condition called as avascular necrosis of the scaphoid bone. Okay. Then lunate is the most common bone which undergoes dislocation. And when the lunate dislocation occurs, it most of the time it compresses the median nerve. Okay. And a clinical condition occurs which is referred to as carpal tunnel syndrome. Then in metacarpals, the fracture of the base of the first metacarpal is referred to as Bennett's fracture, and fracture of the neck of the fifth metacarpal is referred to as Boxer's fracture. Okay, these are the various fractures with respect to the metacarpals. Then in carpal bones, we can determine the age with respect to the number of the carpal bones. While taking x-ray of the breast of the child, counting the number of carpal bones, we can determine the age of the child. Specifically, we can determine age from 3 to 7 years according to the number of the carpal bones. Okay. If, for example, if there are 4 carpal bones seen, that means the age of the child is 4 years. So these are the various applied anatomy related to the articulated hand. So I've tried to cover all the bones in this session. If you have not got this session, then you can look at the particular session of all the individual bones. Every bone I had covered in the previous sessions. This session I had covered it just for revision just before the exams. Okay. So if you will have any doubts, you can ask in the comment section below. Thank you.